Hello everyone and welcome to the Chrissy B Show. Now today I've got lots in store for the programme. I'll be speaking to professional footballer Leon Legge, who plays for Gillingham FC, about his obstacles and success and all about his role as ambassador at the Young Epilepsy Foundation. I'll also be showing you my latest challenge, which was vintage hairstyling. Did I do well or not? You're just going to have to wait and see. We also have our fitness tip from Jane Wrafter, which is all about how to tone up your bottom. And we also have weekly makeup tips from Maegan and Gregoire. And I'll also be answering a question from a viewer. And we have a success story. There's so much to get through. So without further ado, let's introduce Excel with the news. Hello.
Hello, Chrissy. Nice to be here again. Hello, viewers. Yes, I'm good, thank you. I have, as usual, some interesting bits of news for us today. Mm-hmm. Something we can sort of like talk about as well, and you tell me what you think. Okay. I think it's quite interesting. I think I'll start off first with something brief, which is the we all know recently about the couple who decided to consciously uncouple.
I was going around saying decoupling, but it's uncoupling.
No, it's uncoupling. Okay. So it's not divorce or it's not separation. It's conscious uncoupling, which is fantastic. I mean, you know, technology is improving with time. So let's also call things with different names as we go into, you know, further and further into
time. Should we just explain to viewers in case they don't know what uncoupling is?
Well, it was, yes, for those who don't know, actually, it was Gwyneth Paltrow and her husband, what's his name again? Chris Martin. Yeah, well... Sorry.
No. Whatever.
Yeah, so they decided to separate. Chris Martin is the lead singer of Coldplay, for those who don't know. And they decided to separate, but they didn't call it separation or divorce. They decided to call it conscious uncoupling. Who knew? But anyway, while they were together, I mean, Gwyneth Paltrow has always been seen as the sort of she talks about healthy eating and not eating rubbish and always eating. She never takes her kids to fast food restaurants. So Happy Meals never featured on their diet. Hope they were still happy. But anyway,
however, that's a good thing, I suppose. But you know, anyway, let's not get into that.
Yeah, let's not. That's a whole other kettle of fish of discussion. however, recently, after their conscious uncoupling, Chris Martin has been seen in a fast food restaurant. Oh.
Maybe and that's why they're uncoupling.
Maybe that's what it was, yes.
McDonald's.
They wanted, and actually it's a fast food restaurant called Ready Chick. Oh. That's the name, Ready Chick.
So it wasn't McDonald's, it was fried chicken.
It was just, yes. And he was eating chips with his kids, Apple, who's 10, and Moses, who's 8. And apparently they loved it. And there was no kale in sight, or spinach, or carrot, or anything else. They absolutely love their chips. And we can only imagine, of course, what Gwyneth will have to say about it all, but
I wonder if she knows. Well, she knows now, assuming she watches the Chrissy B Show.
I think she does.
Never mind.
Well, moving on to that, to another sort of child-related story, if you like. A nanny was caught stealing from a couple she worked for. So I remember the article I picked it from. Instead of, we all know the famous Nanny McPhee, she's been branded as Nanny McThief because she was spotted stealing jewelry and clothing from a couple.
I'm not laughing because it's funny what she did. I'm just laughing at the name, sorry.
Quite creative, yeah. I have to say, when I saw it.
Yes.
Her name is Pascal Sherwin, and she was rumbled after Becky and Bradley Cannons, both 40, set up hidden cameras to catch her in the act. And she was 29-year-old, and she cared for their 2-year-old daughter. And basically, she was taking clothes from them, but then ended up taking photos of herself and posted on Facebook and tagged the woman in the photo.
Oh, no, how dumb can you get?
Seriously, it was like, who does that? But anyway, she pleaded guilty at Exeter Crown Court to theft from her employer, and she was ordered to do 200 hours of unpaid voluntary work, community work. But Mrs. Cannon said, the lady, Becky, said she hadn't realized it would be her because she was, according as far as she was concerned, she was part of the family. And so when she felt things disappearing from the house, she never thought it could be her, you know. But then again, if you haven't had a break-in, who else could it be? But anyway, but it was the woman's mother who discovered the photos on Facebook and said, hold on a minute, like, that's your top, that's your earring, that's your necklace and all of that. And so the police, they took that to the police, but the police couldn't prosecute until they had actual evidence. So then they set up 5 cameras around the house. And the lady said she thought it was going to be, oh, like, let's just fast forward. But within 5 minutes, she already started pocketing things.
So that's really worrying, because you put someone in your house, you trust them. And it's not even just the fact that she was stealing, but just looking after your children.
Exactly. I mean, what are you passing on to that child?
Exactly. And if you're capable of stealing, you're capable of a lot more.
Exactly.
I really think.
Exactly. It was shocking.
It was really worrying.
Absolutely shocking. And, you know, she when the police then actually went to the lady's house, then they found a stash of stolen jewellery as well as clothes when they searched her home. Mm. And, you know, it's horrendous, really.
Yeah, it probably wasn't a good idea to post things up on Facebook. Well, she didn't want to get caught. Or maybe she wanted to get caught. Anyway.
She shouldn't have stolen in the first place, yes. Well, okay, I'll move on to something else now, which is which was quite creative. It actually made me chuckle. Chloe White from South Wales, came up with a way of raising money because the daughter of a friend suffers from cerebral palsy, so she wanted to raise some funds for to help raise the $100,000 that was needed to pay for her surgery. Mm-hmm. So she decided to, she had come home from a Justin Bieber concert with a shoe, and she she decided to put it on eBay to raise money. So this
shoe?
A shoe, Justin Bieber. Justin Bieber's.
No,
as in a shoe, one shoe, not okay. Both of them.
No, but his shoe.
Yeah.
As in anyone's shoe.
No, as in Justin Bieber's shoe. Okay. She got it from having gone to the concert.
Right.
So she put that put that on eBay to raise money. But at the time of this report, we didn't get a final amount as to what the shoe sold for, one shoe. But I came up with a few other things as well that people have sold in the past.
Hang on, what did you
sell it for? No, that's why I said I don't know. I said at the time of this report, it has gone on eBay. But we don't know the cost of what the shoe actually went for. But
you
then
just see some deranged fan just sniffing his shoe.
But which then led on to a number of other things that I found out that people had been selling for celebrities that they claimed were from celebrities. Mm. Kim Kardashian's used bras.
Oh dear.
Apparently she held a charity sale. And of course, this was featured on Keeping Up with the Kardashians at her home, where she put up various odds and ends for sale. And the weirdest offering was her used bras. It doesn't say how much it sold for, but there you go. Yeah. Get a load of this. A jar containing Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie's breath.
Oh, for goodness sake. I'm sorry.
Went up for sale on eBay.
Oh dear.
And this person called Joe Wilson said, be the first to win this jar of celebrity air.
People at home, everybody, they're just human beings like me and you. Nothing special, just successful, and you can be successful too. Don't jar up their breath and sell it, for goodness sake.
Well, exactly. And even the way that it was described, it says, win this jar of celebrity air, which may contain air molecules that came in direct contact with Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt. May. They could have been in the same town, maybe. They could have probably been at the other end.
You're going to give people ideas on what to sell on eBay now.
Do you know how much it sold for?
Oh God, don't.
Just guess.
A few thousand?
Well, okay, you're a bit ambitious. $523 for a jar of breath.
That is crazy.
You got any empty jars at home, Chrissy? We could raise a few funds.
Okay. That's quite good. Giving me some ideas for some fundraising.
There you go, you never know. A radio station called Z100 nabbed a slice of Justin Timberlake's half-eaten French toast that he left behind after he appeared on The Breakfast Show and put it on eBay. A 19-year-old fan bought it for...
Don't tell me the guest prizes, because I just think it's ridiculous.
$3,154. But all the proceeds were donated to Justin Timberlake's charity.
Okay.
So it was for a good cause. Mm.
Anyway, any more?
I've got a few more. Oh, I've got time.
A few more before we go to a break, because I think absolutely ridiculous, but anyway.
Fans of One Direction, this one's for you. Neil Horan took a bite out of a slice of toast with Vegemite on it on an Australian breakfast TV show, but he promptly spat it out, saying it was horrible. However, the TV station put the toast, but not the spat out bit, on auction to raise cash for a young person's charity for a good cause.
All right. Okay. All right. I can kind of accept it if it's for a good cause, but I still think people are crazy to do things like that. Excel, my love.
Yes,
we'll stop there. You're going to join us on the last part of the show, aren't you?
So absolutely.
We can talk about a few more.
Oh, yes. I've got plenty
more. Other ridiculous news on the Chrissy B Show today. Alrighty, so we're going to be hearing from Leon Legge after the break. He's going to be telling us all about his football career and also epilepsy and how he copes with it. And also how he's helping young people too. So do stay tuned and we'll see you after this break.
Don't forget to subscribe to the Chrissy B Show, always aiming to show you the happier side of life. You can find us on YouTube, Facebook and Twitter.
Welcome back to the show. Now, before I speak to Gillingham FC's Leon Legge, let's take a look at the success story.
We're in the dance studio with one of Britain's top dancers to talk to him about his own success story. Wolf has really appeared on television, has worked with some of the major recording artists around the world, and is a lead dancer and a model. Wolf, it's really good to meet you again today. We've met before. Tell me a little bit about your history of what you've actually done over the past few years and what really inspired you to become a dancer and a model in the first place.
Well, I actually started dancing in university when I was 19 years old, and I kind of just didn't really think it would be a career for me. I just tried my best, like work as hard as I could. I met some incredible people. I danced with my best friend on a show called Got to Dance. The two of us were called Parlour on the show. And when I finished university, we both decided that we wanted to take it to a really professional level. And I guess since then, I've just worked so hard. I've trained in London, I've gone to Paris, I've gone to Los Angeles just to really create myself in as good a dancer as I could be, as much as it's always a growing thing. And I've had the pleasure of dancing with some amazing artists like Lil Mix, Rita Ora, Stussy. It's been unbelievable. So I'm just really thankful for where I am in life at the moment. I guess to be honest, maybe you could say there is some natural rhythm there. I mean, as a kid, I've always loved dancing. I guess I was really influenced by people like Michael Jackson growing up. And yeah, I guess my parents, they like to move in the house every now and so and then. So maybe there is a sense of natural rhythm. But apart from that, I've really worked as hard as I could to get where I am now, especially because I started dancing properly at 19. I started so late. A lot of people start when they're 3, but I started really, really late, and I've just worked so, so hard to get to where I am now. I really and truly believe that if you have a dream, you should just go for it. There's so many kids that I teach, and I say to them every day, if there's something you want to do, you want to be a singer, actor, teacher, anything, you can do it. Like, it doesn't matter when you start. My first dream was to play in the NBA, and, you know, it changed, and now I am achieving my ultimate dream, which is to dance for some unbelievable artists, so anything is possible. I kind of got into modeling about a year ago professionally. I tried it when I was younger, I tried when I was 18, 19, but I didn't actually find any success. A lot of agencies were saying no, and I didn't really believe I had a career in it. So yeah, I guess you could say last year I had a eureka moment, and I decided that I wanted to really push it again. And so I've had great opportunities, especially because dance and modeling go in so well. So I've worked with fashion shows where I've danced and I've modeled at the same time. And also last year I did a Tesco advert, which was heavily based on dancing and modeling.
Okay, thank you very much, Wolf, and well done. Okay, so we have another success story here with me right now, and that's Leon Legge. Hello, Leon.
How you doing? You right?
I'm well. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad, yeah.
Okay, we've got quite a bit to get through, because you're not just going to talk to us about football, but also something else very important. But let's start off with the football, first of all. So you play for Gillingham FC.
Yep.
How's that going?
Yeah, we just finished the season. It was a tough season. We just got promoted to League One. We had a good season. To be fair, we finished around about 14th place,
and
Yes, it's been a good season, yeah.
All right. So have you always known you wanted to be a footballer since you were young, or did you have other dreams for yourself?
I've always wanted to be a footballer. Ever since I was 9 years old, really. Yeah. When I was younger, I was always, you know, always kicking a ball. When I got in from school,
yeah,
I'd go out and play with my mates. I'd play football at school. It was, no matter where you saw me, I always had a football in my hand. So.
Yeah. Okay, and were your family supportive, or were they like, maybe you should do something else, or what, how was your family?
I was always, everyone like in my family come watch me play football on the Sundays and everything, and yeah, so I had a lot of support really from my family.
Oh, that's really good. Now, it hasn't been easy for you though, because at age 16 you discovered that you had epilepsy. Can you talk us through that and what happened?
Yeah, it was, I remember like, clearly, really, I was 16 years old and I was actually at football training, and I remember heading a ball, and then I must have just collapsed, really. I remember waking up and just sort of seeing everyone around me, around 20 players around me, and just looking up in the air, and I just really didn't know what was going on, to be honest.
That must have been really scary for you.
Very scary, because the first seizure I've ever had, and I just didn't know what happened to me, really. Mm. And then just remember sort of being carted off into an ambulance and then sort of talking to the doctors and that in the hospital.
How did that impact your life from then on, now that you discovered that you did have epilepsy? How did it, what was going through your mind? How did it affect you?
Well, the first thing that came to my head was really like, am I ever going to be able to play football again? That was the first thing that jumped into my head.
Dream,
really.
Right?
So. Yeah, definitely. You know, but then talking to the neurologist and having regular meetings with him, he said it was fine. I had to really kind of get the right dosage of medication at the start and try and get it controlled.
Mm-hmm. And what about how did it affect your family, like?
Well, I remember, like, my mum, really, she had a bit of a tough time of it, because at the start I did have quite a few seizures, and I remember quite a few times I'd had some bad ones as well. I remember
How often did it happen?
Well, at the start I reckon a good two a day, really.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
I remember going to bed one time. I was very tired, and I remember going to bed one time and then waking up in the hospital in the same night. So if you think about it, you go into bed and then you wake up in hospital and you think, well, how do I get here?
So yeah.
it was very scary.
Right. And how do you cope with it with football then?
With football, really, I've got to let the physios know I have it. Them being professionals at their job and with the medical side and everything, they would know as well. And the football clubs I've been at, they've been supportive, and when I have had a seizure at football, they've always known what to do. So.
Well, that's really good. So, I mean, might be youngsters watching that do have the same condition. They're thinking, oh my God, my future's over. Not just for football, for anything. And they think that, you know, there's no hope for them, or they can't realise their dreams, but they can.
Oh, definitely. I'm proof of that, really. I've had a lot of people asked me via and Twitter and email how I dealt with it, and sort of gave them advice and little tips and info, and it's helped them.
Okay, now you're ambassador for, was it Young People's?
Young Epilepsy, yeah.
Okay, how did that come about?
That actually came about, I was doing an interview for a newspaper, and it came out in the next day, and then all of a sudden, I got loads of phone calls from different epilepsy charities, and then I've done a few bits like radio interviews and a few articles and things like that, really. And then Young Epilepsy actually asked me if I wanted to be like an ambassador, and I jumped at the chance, really, and it was a massive honour.
Okay, and how have you been helping the youngsters then? Is it sort of telling your story and things like that?
Yeah, you know, letting them know my story and how I dealt with it, and like I say, like personal advice and tips, really. Epilepsy is very like complex, and there's so many different types, and that with every with every person who has epilepsy it's all different to that case. So it is hard to pinpoint certain things with epilepsy and the case of that person. So.
Okay. And what would you say to a youngster that's watching now that has epilepsy, that maybe has just been diagnosed and they're really worried about their future? What would you say to them?
I'd say what I normally say, really. You know, when I've had people ask me through email and things like that, it comes down to what is that can set them off to have a seizure, really. Mm-hmm. So say, like, for example, I've spoke to someone who has a seizure when he plays too much computer games, and because it's a neurological thing, and that can mentally fatigue you if you're playing on a computer for so long. Okay. I've advised him, well, if you're playing it for a certain amount of hours, you need to cut that down, because otherwise you're in danger of having...
They listen.
Yeah, so you're in danger. But, yeah. You know, I've been there, I've been a kid, and...
It's hard, isn't
exactly
it?
You want to same. Do, yeah. I used to play computer when I was younger, so... Yeah. But, you know, avoiding that, it can definitely help and cut the seizures down, definitely.
Yeah. But I can imagine a lot of kids look up to you as well, and it's great what you're doing.
Yeah, it's nice to be, like, an idol to people who have epilepsy. Yeah.
So there is, you know what, there is good that comes out of sometimes, you know, life hits you with blows and you start to think, you know, why me? But you can always find something positive or to help other people with the same thing. So there's always something that you can do with certain problems that come your way, with certain issues, isn't there?
Yeah, there's certainly ways around it.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, with me, in my case, for me to sort of avoid having a seizure, I have to have plenty of rest, because they found with me, I didn't used to get too much sleep. I used to say have 5 or 6 hours and I'll be all right. But that could cause me to have a seizure. And
so you just have to know the truth.
So with me, I decided, well, if this is what's making me have a seizure, I'll get 8 hours sleep instead.
And well, it's a good reason to get more sleep.
If I did feel fatigued, you know, a little power nap or anything like that, you know, and whereas I'm playing a very high intense sport, then, you know, I have to sort of kind of be careful there. Careful. So if I felt tired, like say from training or something, then I'd, you know, take a rest and, you know.
Okay. And just before you go, Leon, what are your future plans?
My future plans? I'm hoping to do coaching badge, really. I want to sort of get into media as well, so options, really. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think you're going to be great, eh? Well, thanks so much for speaking to us. I'm sure you've inspired lots of youngsters and people in general. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, so do stay tuned, because after the break, I'll be speaking to Maegan with some makeup tips and also be showing you my latest challenge, so don't go away.
Don't forget to subscribe to The Chrissy B Show, always aiming to show you the happier side of life. You can find us on YouTube, Facebook and Twitter.
Welcome back. Now, before we go to Maegan's makeup counter, let's take a look at my latest challenge. Hi everyone, today I'm going to be doing a very different kind of challenge. Now, most of my challenges have been very sporty based, things like that, but today I'm going to be doing something completely different, and that is to try and do a vintage hairstyle. Now, I'll be up against someone. This is Anna, everyone. She'll be up against me. We're going to be doing the challenge timed to see who does the best vintage hairstyle. You looking forward to it?
Yes.
Me too. And I have to say, I'm not very good at hairstyling and stuff, so this is definitely a challenge for me, and I'm really looking forward to it. Let's go. Yeah. I'm here with
with senior hairstylist Danielle. She's going to be telling us right now what we'll be doing for this challenge. Hi, Danielle.
Hi.
I'm so looking forward to this.
It should be
really
fun. Different.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. I love your look, by the way. It's
thank
great.
You.
So how are we going to be running through this challenge today?
So I'll be demonstrating on one of the other stylists who work here as well, Victoria. I'll be showing you a few tips on how to do vintage rolls, and then you'll have to replicate it.
Great, looking forward to it. Okay, guys, let's go then.
So we're going to do some curls in the hair first, and you go in, twist the tongs around, and pull them straight out with them bent so they curl the hair. Okay, so now we're going to do the top victory roll, and then you have to wrap the hair around your fingers in a roll. And just roll it through. And then pin in the middle.
Ready? Okay, let's go.
We're ready to start the challenge. Ready, set, go.
This is a lot harder than it actually looks, people. Okay.
There's 3 minutes left, ladies.
Okay, I know I'm not looking great at the moment, but I'm trying. No, what's that thing sticking out? I just look like I've got curlers in my hair, that's it. I'm off in style. Okay. How long do we have left?
1 minute.
No, we'll just fix this one.
No, it's fallen.
It's not fair. Oh, the clip's gone. No.
Time out, pins down. Done. Okay, Chrissy, we'll have a look at yours first. Okay. You had 5 minutes to replicate the hairstyle. How do you think
went? It looks nothing like it, does it? It's just really messy.
We're a bit loose on this side. But that's okay, you would have just needed to do a bit more teasing and then rolled it up a little bit tighter and then pinned it. How was the challenge?
Yeah, it looks very much easier than when you're doing.
You did a really good job. You only did 2, so Chrissy did 3, but they're very nice and very well pinned, and you can definitely see the curl through there. It looks great.
Right, so now it's time to find out who won this challenge, Danielle.
Okay, so the winner of the victory roll challenge is Anna.
Oh, right.
I'm so much better at the sporty challenges. Never mind, I'm not too good at the makeup and hair. Oh dear. Hello, we have Maegan with us. We're at our counter today. How are you?
Hello, I'm good, Chrissy. How are you?
I'm well, really good.
You look fabulous.
She did my makeup, that's why she's saying that. Thank you,
no,
my darling.
No, because she does look fabulous. Oh,
thank you. So what we're going to talk about today, you've got all these brushes out for
I
us.
Do. I have all these brushes. I've got some different bits here. I'm going to talk about hygiene of your kit and hygiene of your brushes and why that's important and how you can do it.
Okay, cool.
Okay. So when you're dealing with makeup, your own makeup, there's sometimes where there can be dirt that gets into the bits. Now, what happens is with powder, there's bacteria. So let's say you're using your brushes, you're not cleaning your brushes, they get dirt on them, you're putting it into the product, then it's then festering.
Spread and, all over your face.
Exactly.
And you get lots of lovely spots.
Exactly. So, it couldn't be the sole reason, right? Mm. Diet and everything can be a producer of blemishes and that, but it could be that you're not sanitizing your products as well. Okay. Not only that is, I've got a couple pictures of some product that has had some dirt in there. Also, with shadows and eyeshadows, you lose that pigmentation. So you might have, two layers of this kind of hardness on top mm-hmm. of the powder, and you're not getting any powder, any color, because it's not clean. Oh. So, you know, when you first get a fresh bronzer, or you first get a fresh eyeshadow, mm-hmm. basically you would get that nice soft layer. So you dip into that, you know, just out of the package, and you'd get that pigment. But if you have a layer on top of there that, especially with powders, that is preventing you from getting that pigment, then you're not going to have a nice application.
Should we take a look at the first picture?
Yeah.
Let's take a look.
Yeah. So let's see what I'm talking about and how we can prevent that and how we can clean that. So there we have some it's actually cake eyeliner, but it's a powder. And there you can see that there's different strokes in there that haven't been cleaned properly. How would I prevent that from happening? Because one, when I dip my brush in there, I'm not going to get a nice color pigment on my brush. Also, there's bacteria in there. You don't want that, especially as a makeup artist. You definitely don't want that to be, you know, on your track record as a makeup artist. You definitely want to be cleaning your cake. You can simply wipe the top of it. Now, this is a cream, but wipe the top layer. You don't want to go too much and it comes right off. So, you know, just with the tissue or you know, just a nice soft wipe and you get that clean. Mm-hmm. That is, like I said, that is cream. Now, you would get that same thing with a powder. Now, there's different other types of products out there. There's sanitizing sprays that you can just spray on like that right after you use.
You don't need to wipe it, you just spray it immediately.
You don't wipe, you spray. You can wipe in addition to that, because there's, what you're doing is you're taking that layer off, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, you've put your dirty brush in there, or maybe it wasn't a dirty brush, but then once you put it on your face, it essentially is, you know, it's not clean anymore. It's not sanitary. And you don't have to clean your brushes all the time if you're just using them for you, but you do want to have a clean.
Yeah.
For a number of reasons. One, because yes, after a while, that bacteria is going to. So I would say, you know, once or twice a week. Once or twice every 2 weeks.
Right, okay.
Sort of thing, like depending on what you're using it for. For instance, we can recall a little blush brush that I had seen at Wembley.
Yes, Maegan came to do my makeup at Wembley when we had the Love School last year at Wembley Arena. And she did my makeup and then she had to go. And then I said, don't worry, I can powder myself with this brush. And I presented this brush and she looked horrified. She goes, you're not going to use
was
that.
A brush massively caked with, you know, some nice blusher that would not look so nice on camera. Thank gosh that I actually caught that.
She left me with one of her brushes.
I left her one of the brushes, returned it to me at the studio. But that's the thing, is the pigment. So if you would have put a blush brush on all over your face with that powder I left you, you're gonna leave that pigment trace. Yeah. So the same thing goes with eyeshadow brushes. Mm-hmm. So you're going into different colors. Well, it's not the same color anymore when you apply it because you're not cleaning it.
Right.
So there's a number of ways to clean brushes. So there's a quick brush cleaner. So you can just spray that on. That one's Quick Change Bare Minerals, but there's also different brush cleaners out there. Mm-hmm. I know MAC does one. There's lots of different
brands.
I've
heard people that use shampoo to clean their brushes
as well.
That's
another thing, is you don't want to be using just any shampoo, but I mean, and obviously a professional cleaner is going to maintain your brushes, but there's also a diluted soft baby shampoo, warm water. So you would get a bowl, warm water, a little bit of baby shampoo. It's just mild. Mm-hmm. The key is mild. You don't want, you know, perfume or alcohol, anything like that. You want a natural, diluted soapy water. So you put your brush in it, and the key is there's going to be color coming out of it. So you want to just give it a good rinse and then run it under warm water until it runs clear.
Right. And then
set it out like this on the way after you've done that, and it will be dry in about 6 hours. You can also wipe off the moisture and then do that. So you can do that for all of them. Now, another thing I want to talk about is the different ways you can clean this. So in order to preserve the hygiene of, let's say, a pot of liquid liner, or let's say that's a liquid eyeshadow, you can take the layer off with a Q-tip, right? So also when you're actually applying it, you can take it with a Q-tip mm-hmm. and you can then apply that. You don't want to be sticking your dirty fingers in there. You can do, and there's nothing wrong with that. But do you know what? Give it a little kind of wipe after.
Right.
Okay. Do you know, if you only could see, you know when people have those neon lights and they see
yeah,
all those?
I can imagine.
If you could only see, I mean, come on, you've got the sniffles, you've had your hand on the tube button, just give it a little wipe. It doesn't sound nice. You don't want that on your face. You don't think that's going on your face, but that's what it is. How you can sanitize pencils, you can sharpen the first layer off. You don't have to spray with, an alcohol-based
to kill the germs. What about lipsticks?
Lipsticks, obviously, for makeup artists as well, or let's say if you're sharing, which you shouldn't really do. There's the disposable lip ones and for mascaras. You definitely don't want to be sharing mascara that's directly with the eye.
Yeah.
You want to be using these, so don't double dip because that's obviously defeating the purpose. But with lipsticks, you can just give them a good wipe. Give them a good wipe just like the top of it. And that's getting the first layer of that product off. And so it is essentially sanitized. Now you can spray like this. This is, it's called Beauty Be Clean. There's other ones out there. And some people even use alcohol diluted with water, spray it. It kills the, disinfects, and then they wipe as well. But wiping, if you do get that first layer off, you don't have to do both. And so on. So
now, Maegan, I know you brought a load of brushes here to show us which brushes to use for what item, which is really useful. Well, we've run out of time, so you're going to
have to do that next, because
to tell you the truth, I don't know what she does with all these brushes, but there's so many different ones, and and I'd love to know.
There's a purpose for each of them.
Exactly. So she tells me there's a purpose for each of them, so I would really like to learn about that, and I'm sure our viewers at home would as well.
Absolutely.
So we're going to have to save that for the next one.
Perfect.
Okay, keep so thank you suspense. So much. So first of all, everybody, please keep your brushes clean, and I should be going home and shampooing all my brushes.
Absolutely.
Although I don't have a child shampoo, I have to get one, so maybe I'll do that tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Okay, so do stay tuned because Excel will be back with us, and I'll also be showing you a video from Jane Wrafter on how to tone your bum. So do join us after this.
Don't forget to subscribe to The Chrissy B Show. Always aiming to show you the happier side of life. You can find us on YouTube, Facebook and Twitter.
Welcome back. Now, before we go to Jane's fitness tip, let me just answer this question from a viewer. She says, "Hi, Chrissy. I'm pregnant, but I'm scared to tell my mum as she made me have an abortion once. I don't like hiding the truth, but I'm scared. She doesn't like my partner and gives me a hard time to leave him. What can I do?" Now, this is a very tricky one. There's not a lot of detail here in terms of what your age is and everything, but I'm assuming that you're over 16 because you have a partner and everything. I don't know. The first thing I have to say is mums do worry, and generally they want the best for their children, so try and see things from her point of view. But the question is, why wouldn't she want you to have the baby? Is it because you're too young? Is it because she doesn't, she doesn't like your partner because he may be mistreating you? Are you not financially stable? So you need to look at all of these issues as well. But at the end of the day, the fact is you are pregnant, and no one can actually force you to have an abortion. Maybe she's pressurized you in the past, but at the end of the day, it is your decision. And if you do decide to go ahead with the pregnancy, then it's your choice. You can't let someone else force you to do something that you don't want to do. But I would say, just make sure that if you are in any negative circumstances, be it financial, be it problems with your partner, all of those things, please, please do take this into consideration. Make sure you get help for your relationship if that's the problem. Try to get financially stable. Do everything that you can. So if you do go ahead to have this child, then you can bring it into the best possible circumstances. And as for your mum, I'm sure she'll come round once she sees a little bouncing baby. If you do decide to go ahead, then I'm sure she'll come round. So I hope that's helped. And if you want to email me with any question, any dilemma that you have, you can do so on chris@chrissybshow.tv. Okay, let's go to Jane's fitness tip, and then afterwards we're going to be back to talk with Excel.
Hi everyone, it's Jane here with your fitness tip, and today I want to talk about toning up the bum. And thanks to several celebrities lately, such as Rihanna and Kim Kardashian, she's extreme, but it is fashionable to have a really nice, full, round and toned up bum, which I'm all in favour of. So I'm going to show you a couple of things that you can do at home to really help improve the tone and strength of your bum muscles, your gluteus maximus, okay? So we're going to maximise your gluteus maximus. So the first one is a Pilates exercise. So if you lie on your back like this with your knees bent and then lift your pelvis up and come into a shoulder bridge. Now, what I want you to do is start to squeeze into your bum muscles. Make sure your knees don't flare to the side. Even pressure across the soles of your feet. So you need the balls of your feet on the floor as well. What I want you to do now is just drop your bottom halfway down and then tilt it slightly underneath so that your tailbone just locks up a little bit. And the reason for that is I don't want anyone to arch their back in this exercise. You need to keep your back supported. Full squeeze in the bum. Level one, you keep all your toes on the floor and you lift one heel. And then you put more pressure in the other foot and change. This is level one, okay? So you squeeze into your bum all the time. Now, if you're prone to hamstring cramp or you've got any back problems, stick with this option, okay? Now, if you've already got reasonable strength in your bum, this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna lift the heel, and then we're gonna gradually give control to the other leg till we lift the other leg in the air. I'm gonna flex the foot, lower it, and lift. Now, I want you to watch my back. It's not arching, it's not moving. I'm using my abdominals actually to create core strength. But I'll tell you where I'm feeling this. The left side of my bum, here. If I show you on this side, I can really feel it here. So I'm strengthening and tightening up through the glutes, lift the leg up. I'm gonna lower and lift, lower and lift with control, squeezing the glutes. Have a go at this, it's really challenging, but it's really effective. You'll notice that you really have to keep this glute switched on when you do this exercise, okay. I'm gonna come down for a little rest. This is a nice stretch for the bum in between your exercises, by the way. Just a simple pulling of the knees will release it off. Another nice easy one for you, you bring your knees together. The bonus of this one is actually, it targets your inner thighs as well, which is another area we all want to improve, I think. A lot of women do ask me about that. So squeeze those knees and lift your bottom up in the air. Now I'm squeezing my gluteus maximus, my bum, I'm squeezing my inner thighs, my knees, my ankles, it's all squeezed. I'm just gonna lower and lift. So this one is similar to the other one, except you've got both legs on the floor, so it's a little bit easier. So if you didn't fancy the other one, have a go at this one. It is easier, but I'm squeezing all the time, compressing into the glutes. Okay, I'm gonna show you one more quick one, all right? Whiz over onto your front, relax down onto your chest, and squeeze your bum muscles, lift your knees off the floor, and float your feet up, and then lengthen the legs, and just hold. And you feel it here, and in the thighs as well. So you hold it for a few breaths and then release. And then take a breath, exhale and lift and squeeze into the bum. Hold and relax. So that's a nice simple one there. So guys, get stuck into your glute exercises. And you know what? When you're just sitting around, driving around, walking around, squeeze into your bum muscles whenever you think about it because it will strengthen them up. Okay, good luck with it and I'll see you next time.
Thank you very much to the lovely Jane. So we've got time for a couple more news pieces, I think, Excel.
Yes, but I have to say, Jane has given me some tips there. I think I shall be practicing some of those. Yes, I do.
Do you exercise, Excel?
Sometimes, but I tend not to. I'm not the gym kind of, you know, the grunting and all the puffing and all that that goes on in the gym. I'm not part of that. I like my nature type scenery.
I said exercise, not relaxation.
Nature, as in you can go walking, that burns calories.
Well, it depends what pace you're going at.
Power walking. She doesn't believe me. Oh, well. Moving on swiftly. Okay. Well, you would not believe this next thing. Actually, you know what? I think I'll save that for last. We know Lady Gaga, don't we?
Not personally, but yeah, I know of her.
We know of her, exactly. And everything she does, you know, she does the whole flamboyant yes. dressing and mm-hmm. the whole meat dresses and all of that, yes. Now, everything she touches as well, apparently, it's a big deal. A teacup that she used at a press conference. Teacup. Teacup and saucer. She used at a press conference at a conference called We Pray for Japan in 2011, raised, wait for it, $75,000. Apparently, the money also went...
Maybe I should save Leon's glass. Did he drink anything out of it?
I know, isn't it? That would have been bad.
I don't think he took any drinks and he didn't take any...
He didn't touch anything. No, but he touched
did
the door.
Did he have a cup of tea?
He touched the door, so we might just lift his fingerprint and sell it on eBay, yeah. The money went towards an art fellowship program, so you could say it went for a good cause as well. Right. Okay, I think I'll do this one next. A New Jersey businessman got hold of Michael Jackson's underwear.
Oh, God.
They were white, size 28 Calvin Klein briefs, and he got it in a bankruptcy case. So I suppose they would have probably cleared out everything in Michael Jackson's house as part of the case. And obviously there were a few pair of white fronts in there.
Were they clean at least?
I hope so. Apparently they were confiscated as part of the evidence in 2003 by the former DA Tom Snedden, who wanted a DNA sample for his child molestation case against Jackson. And the underwear actually came in an evidence bag as well, the same way it was used and wrapped in police tape and all of that.
M&S?
And he put them up for auction with a reserve of $1 million. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Last one. Britney That's it now. Don't want to hear anymore.
I've got two more. Britney Spears. A London fan of Britney Spears sold a piece of chewing gum that she spat out during a Wembley gig.
And she
sold it for £50. That was just, you know. However, in 2004, when she spat another one out at a Toronto gig, that one sold for $14,000.
Wow.
Have you got any chewing gum?
No, thank you very much. I'll dispose of it myself, thank you.
And finally...
Oh, God, I'm trying to shut her up, but she keeps going on.
I have to save the best for last. Scarlett Johansson, in 2008, went on the Jay Leno show, and she was suffering from a cold, so as you do, she reached for a tissue, and she went, achoo! And threw it away.
And how much did the soiled tissue
And
raise?
It raised $5,000 for a hunger charity, USA Harvest.
Okay. Guys, okay, look, I can stomach if it's for charity, but if it's just fans just keeping these things, I think it's really, really out of order.
But the thing is, even if it is for charity, like...
Well, at least there's something good coming out of it.
Someone's paid money for someone's snot.
But thank you very much, Excel. Thank you so much for that.
I hope you're not eating while we're doing this.
News that you've shared with us. But that's all we've got time for today, unfortunately. We do have to go. I hope you've enjoyed the programme today. And if you want more information, you can visit the website, chrissybshow.tv. And if you haven't liked our Facebook page, you can go there right now for behind the scenes pictures and lots of lovely content and inspirational stuff. And that's The Chrissy B Show. And of course, if you want to email me, chris@chrissybshow.tv. And remember, you can be happy. If you're going through down in the dumps, if you're going through any kind of issues at the moment, you can always be happy with the right help and the right direction. See you next time. Bye-bye for now. So today, everyone, I'm down at Laser... my shouting. I should stop shouting down the microphone.
Okay. And obviously, paintball just takes... You get a good adrenaline rush from paintball, whereas laser's more for the little ones.